Thank you very much. Actually, many thanks for inviting me, Mario. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be here. I'm impressed to be called a distinguished lecturer. I hope that I can make it up. So today I will basically try to talk about my research at the university. And I realize that maybe some of you are not familiar with power systems. Is that correct? So I will probably give you some information that is generic. Sorry for those that are experts in power systems. So then I will basically talk about simulation analysis of power systems, and I will discuss issues regarding computation of transients. Then I will concentrate specifically on this topic and the research that we are doing. And then I will, oops, these things move very quickly, eh? Okay, it changed it. I hope it's not automatic. Okay, so basically, as Mario said, I have spent 17 years working at Hydro-Québec as a research engineer. It was the best time of my life because I was doing only one thing, you know, developing EMTP-RV. And my job was called researcher, but I didn't like that job because researcher means that you don't find anything. So I prefer to say researcher and finder. So I actually decided to find something and to deliver something. So I delivered the MTP-RV. If you are familiar, MTP-RV is a commercial product now, and you can find it if you go to the web. When I was doing that, nobody would believe that it's feasible in a research center to develop a software tool. Everybody thought it's impossible. It will take 50 years and it will never finish. It will never work. It will bug. And they already said, everybody said to me that, you know, we are nothing compared to the big industry that can develop software. But it's not true. I think my motivation in life is that you can do anything you want. And it's not true that you cannot come up with the software that can actually become commercial and, you know, destabilize actually competitors, okay? So it's a quite competitive software. So then I became a professor at Ecole Polytechnique, but I continue still developing EMTP-RV. It was the best time in my life. Now it is the best days of my life. It's different. It's kind of a funny job to be a professor. I mean, I encourage everybody to become a professor. It is the best job, okay? First of all, you are paid to write papers, okay? It's unbelievable, you know. Why they pay you to do that? And then you are paid to travel and present papers at conferences, okay? And have a beer with your friends like Mario. And then you are paid to have fun 70 hours a week. Of course, many hours, but you are not really working. It is like a religion, you know. It's not a job, you know. You are doing that because there's nothing else that you know to do, and you love it, you know. It's quite an amazing job. I mean, of course, it's a lot of hard work, but you don't realize it. Once you start doing it, it does it on its own. It's like it goes, you know. You cannot stop it anymore, okay? So as I said, my approach is that anything can be done, and you know, there are no limits, and every problem can be solved. Actually, there is a saying, I don't know if you know this, there is a book from Charles Dickens, A Tale of Two Cities, and it starts with this phrase. It says it was the best times, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, okay? Every day when you wake up, it is the best of times in your life, and it is also the worst times. Why? Well, I'll give you an example. Let's say you are giving a talk somewhere or you are receiving a prize. At the same time, you might have somebody in your family that has cancer. So it's always the best and the worst, continuously, every day, you know? There is something fantastic and something bad, okay? So this is always in my mind, okay? Then a typical day in my life is basically spinning the plates. I don't know if you know this magic trick is that the magician has poles and he has plates and he has to make sure that the plates do not fall. So this is what I do in the morning. I start with the family, then the students, then the papers, and I give them a spin continuously, okay, so they don't fall. Of course, some plates like the dog or some, you know, somebody like that, you can allow that it spins a little bit slower, but you should not break any plates, okay? So it's a magic trick that you do until basically you fade away. Okay, just to give you a brief background on us, basically, I am coming from Montreal. In Quebec, we have many universities. These are the number of universities, and the other province is Ontario that has 14. Ecole Polytechnique is located in the University of Montreal, which is in Montreal. You can see some interesting numbers here. You can see that you know, we have 37 schools of engineering, the number of students that we are graduating at undergraduate level, and the number of students that we have at graduate level. This is my university. Actually, my office is in the old building. It's somewhere over here. And this is the new building that is only electrical engineering, okay? And it's a kind of a green building, you know, because today everything is smart grid, everything is, I mean, So everything is nice. So it basically has a lot of modern things related to energy conservation. And then we have also a pavilion with Bombardier. You are probably familiar. Bombardier is an aerospace company in Quebec. It's one of the largest. And then this is the University of Montreal. Okay, so basically this is the location. As you will saw, you will see in the back, there is a cemetery. Okay. So it's a bit strange. Maybe, you know, what happens is we work, and then the plates actually collapse, and then we end up there. It's possible. Okay, so Ecole Polytechnique, very quickly again, it was founded in 1873 with the University of Montreal and the School of Business, which is called HEC. It's the Canada's second largest university complex. We have about 6,000 students. We have 900 degrees awarded per year. So we have about now 230 professors, although this number is going down because the majority of professors are old, okay? They are retiring. So, and these are all the disciplines that we have. Of course, myself, I'm in electrical engineering, and we also have two programs only at the graduate level. Now, nuclear engineering is probably less popular because we don't build any nuclear stations anymore. We had only one in Quebec, and we decided to shut it down because we have a lot of hydro, basically, 90% and more. So this to give you an idea on the number of professors in Canada, Ecole Polytechnique, we have 223. And so we have a record number of professors as compared to the University of Toronto, okay? These are the number of PhD students. As you can see, we graduate many PhD students, okay? Myself, I have 20 students and I have 10 PhD, actually 12, I forget the count. So basically the other students are master students, okay? In our universities, they encourage you to get PhD students and master students because they pay the tuition fees, and this way the university is able to gather the funding for the university. So now let's go and talk a little bit about power systems. So I guess you are familiar with power systems a little bit. Power systems are essential. Without power, there is nothing you can do. I think we can always say that there is no power, there is no life, right? There is no cell phone. There is no Facebook. My daughters will be unhappy. No computers, okay? Nothing will work. No medical equipment will work. So power is essential, okay? It is the source of energy that has the fastest growth today. Let's give you some numbers, 20 trillion kilowatt hours will be reached in 2015, okay? Unfortunately, there are still 2 billion humans without electric power. If you had an occasion to fly over some countries like Africa, you will see that there are pockets of places that is completely dark during night, okay? Because there is no light, there is no electricity. Same in other countries. So there is the need to continue building and increasing the penetration of electricity. What is a power system? Well, a power system is a complex electrical network. Basically, what you do is you have synchronous machines that are generating. This could be driven, for example, by water when you are in Quebec. And these machines, they have controls, okay? They have controls for controlling the voltage at the bus, controlling also the power. And we have to schedule, we have to decide how much power we want to generate at this particular machine. If you have only a hydraulic system, then there is no cost issue. But if you have a mix of hydraulic and thermal issue, you can try to optimize and use more hydraulic. And then you have transformers. Basically, we raise the voltage. And then we have transmission lines and we have loads. Sometimes the loads are local. These loads can actually represent a huge network, could be a distribution system, could be another transmission system, okay? And then, we have other loads and other stations, and then we have sometimes also interconnections with other levels of voltage, in this case, 500 kV. So if you look into the details of this thing, well, you will see inside all the controls that are used to actually, control the synchronous machine. This is actually taken from the MTPRV software, but the basic idea here is that you can assemble this on the screen as it is, and you can make simulations, you can make computations. So very quickly, without going into all these details, the power system has several states. It has the normal state in which basically we are in steady state, and this is the case always, right? It's amazing how reliable power systems are, right? You don't have blackouts that much, right? I don't know if some of you have been to a blackout here, but it doesn't happen often, okay? You usually have lights all the time, and you take it for granted, okay? Many people that they don't even think of it. It's always there, okay? And actually, if we want to increase the salaries of electrical engineers in power systems, we have to have some blackouts once in a while, okay? This way they will realize that we are important, okay? Then we could enter into another stage, which is the alert stage if something goes wrong. For example, if we are falling in generation margins. And we can also enter into very bad conditions, which is basically close to network collapse. What is the objective? Always we have to control the frequency. We have to make sure that there is 60 hertz or 50 hertz everywhere. We have also to assume that the voltages are at nominal value, okay? Otherwise, the protection systems will basically detach the network. And the same for the frequency control. And then we can enter into bad conditions, for example, storms and that kind of stuff. So this gives you an overall good idea of what is going on, okay? If you look at any point to, if you take a look at the waveform in the power system, there is always the steady state, okay? Nothing happens. And then suddenly there is a disturbance, okay? And as you see, the disturbance has a different content now. You have higher frequencies, and then you have a very high frequency here, okay? You have to zoom on it almost, okay? And then you get a new steady state. This is always the case. As you see, when we are in this region of the steady state, things are very easy. This is just a phaser, right? Here also, but in between, it's not so easy, okay? So we have a condition that is using, you know, the power system has different frequencies depending on what's happening. Normally, we want only this mode, but we have to survive through these modes. Survive by meaning, for example, that we have to avoid over voltages or disturbances that can collapse the equipment. If you look at the classification of phenomenon, what you realize is that we have things that can happen in power systems like lightning that are extremely fast, okay? And this is the time scale. What I mean by that is if I want to take this waveform and synthesize it, this is the kind of time step I should use to be able to analyze it, okay? Of course, when we go up the scale, things become much slower, so I don't need to have such a sampling rate, okay? So switching events, subsynchronous resonance, these are different phenomena that are related more to electromechanical interactions between the transmission system and the mechanical machine system, okay? So, but they are usually slower, okay? And then we get into long-term dynamics, for example, people that are adjusting taps on transformers, people that are making corrections or starting new power plants on that kind of stuff, regulation of tie lines, and daily load following. So in that sense, if you look at the beginning here, only this part, the fast part, we are talking more about electromagnetic transients, okay? I don't know why it says fast, but it should be fast, okay? Sorry for that. So detailed tools must be used. Very often we use waveform analysis, so detailed analysis. Actually, my point today, and this is actually what I'm trying to do for the next years, is that this range, this square can be extended. For the moment, people use it at high frequency only, but I think we can use it for anything, okay? So it can become the basis of computing anything in power systems. What is it they do traditionally for things that are slower? They use basically what we call electromechanical transient analysis, so we use transient stability tools, okay? These are for slower phenomenons, and we are using approximations, and we are using phasor solutions, so we don't have the waveform, okay? I don't know if you are familiar here with tools like PSSE or Eurostag, or, you know, these are the tools that are used in this family. And then there is EMTP type of tools like EMTP-RV that are used in this section. My objective is to extend this range and to basically use the kernel of EMT to apply to anything we want. So in that sense, we are dealing with something that is multi-time frame, right? So we have different time frames in the power system. We have things that are slow and things that are fast. Okay, so let's look a little bit at simulation of analysis. So what is the rationale? Is basically modeling and simulation are essential, okay? You need that, and if you are able to deliver advanced simulation methods, you can increase the sophistication level of power systems. You can optimize them. You can make them much more robust. And you can use very fancy things like power electronics, HVDC. HVDC is very popular in Europe, for example. And you can also, of course, every time you present a speech on power systems, you have to say the word smart grids, okay? It's very important today. So if you want to do smart grids, you need simulation tools. In fact, the smarter they become, the more knowledge you have about them, and the more you can analyze them and you can simulate them. So power system simulation needs and complexity levels increase faster than the capabilities of researchers to deliver new models and methods. You know, the demand is very, very high. people want real-time simulators, offline simulators of very large networks, very complex problems, but they do not really exist today, okay? Because research is falling behind. It's complicated to deliver this. And we want it fast, immediately, okay? We want fast computations. We don't want to wait. Nobody wants to wait, okay? So we have to really deliver very fast computation tools, and the faster they are, we can visualize more complex problems if they are extremely fast. And then we can deliver better power systems, okay? So is it possible to calculate the waveform anywhere in a power system? Yes, okay? So we can, for example, use a tool that pretends to be an oscilloscope, okay? And you can probe anywhere in a power system, and you can have a good electronic copy of your power system, and you can analyze it in details. So you can deal with transients that are slow, fast, as I showed you, and different categories of transients. Why should we study them? Well, there are many, many reasons. System design, performance analysis, avoid equipment damage, protection, load shedding, avoid blackouts. Blackouts, they are extremely expensive, could cost billions of dollars, okay? So you have to make sure that you have delivered a very robust network and you are managing it. So basically, you can save millions if you use simulation tools, okay? And analysis. So this is a typical transient, on a typical network where you are energizing this breaker so you can watch the voltages on the transmission system. This is another transient here where you have a synchronous machine, a line, you have arrestors, a transformer that is a nonlinear component. And as you can see, everything is going well, and suddenly we drop the load. When we drop the load, for some reason, there is a ferroresonance phenomenon between the transformer and the line. And then suddenly the protection of the line drops the line, so eventually you discharge and you go to zero, okay? So this is the typical study of transients. I am using it for a small system here, but we can make very big systems. So as you realize, when I'm studying transients, I'm basically taking any waveform. This is a waveform, and I'm trying to analyze it with a fixed time step, okay? Because this is not a symbolic computation, this is a numerical computation. Okay. So there are two ways, basically, I can do that. One of the ways is I can use offline computations. Offline computations like my computer here, basically EMTP type of tool, on which I am simulating. And to do this time step of delta T, let's say it is 10 micro, 1 micro, I don't know. It could take me less or more time on my computer, typically more. But sometimes less, if you calculate the entire simulation, sometimes the computer can be faster than real time. Okay, depending on the network. But it is not synchronized with the clock, right? And then there is another family that you are probably familiar with, is the real-time simulation, okay? Real-time simulators like OpalRT, you have it here, Mario has one, HyperSim and RTDS. So these are synchronized with the wall clock. Of course, when you do that, it is much more complicated in the sense that you have much less mathematical luxury, okay? Because everything you do takes time, so you have to relax. It is a little bit, it is less accurate, okay? And you cannot use very small time steps. And in this family, there are no limitations. I mean, it can take any time you want. You don't care. It can be extremely accurate, okay? So if you look basically today, very quickly, there are many phrases here, but basically offline simulation tools, the models are using separate models for slow and fast transients. We do not use the multi-time frame concept in the sense that we basically assume everything in the same time frame. All the codes, most of the codes are sequential. It means that they use one core, okay? And they use a fixed time step. And we can apply some parallelization on subnetworks through delay-based transmission line models. Maybe you are familiar, but transmission line models actually create a natural decoupling, okay, which is good for parallelizing on a multi-core computer. And almost none of them have parallelization for sparse matrix solvers because we are solving very big problems, so we need sparse matrices. There is no unification. It means that offline tools are far apart from real-time tools. It means that, the engineer has to use one tool for real-time, another one for offline. Phasor domain tools that are using transient stability analysis, they are really reaching applicability limits, especially with wind generation, etc. Hybrid methods are not used, so there is no combination between phasor domain and time domain tools. There is no accuracy navigator. You cannot decide what accuracy you want. It decides for you based on the time step you gave, okay? So there are many problems to fix, okay? If you look at the real-time simulation tools, mostly, you know, all of them are using a special computer. You cannot use real time on this laptop, okay? It's not straightforward. In a real-time simulator, you cannot just push start, okay? It's much more complicated than that. You have to get involved. Most of them, I mean, they use iterative solvers a little bit, I mean, iterative solution methods, but it's starting, but it's not generalized. They parallelize using, again, transmission lines. Of course, you cannot go to very small time steps, more and more now due to FPGA, but it requires work. It's complicated to simulate large systems. And of course, adaptive models do not exist. And again, there is no unification with offline codes. So let's look at some problems and what we can do today and what we want to do. Okay. So this is very nice. It looks like, you know, for me, it's like art. Okay. This is done using MTPRV in Hydro-Québec. Basically, in Hydro-Québec, we have a 735 kV system. But at some point, we go to 350 kV, etc. In this particular region of Quebec, which is called Gaspésie, where we have a lot of wind generators. Can you see all these wind generators? So eventually, this is going to reach about 4 gigawatts. Okay, and these wind generators are provided by different manufacturers. Okay, so for example, you can see, I don't know if you are familiar with wind generation. For example, you can see Enercon, you can see Repower, you can see GE. These are the main manufacturers of wind generation components. Okay, and so they all interconnect to the Hydro-Québec grid. Okay, but Hydro-Québec is a very sophisticated company. They do not accept that you connect to them like that. Okay, they want to make sure that when you connect to them, you do not create disturbances in their system. Okay, what kind of disturbances? Well, there are rules, for example, for reaction of the wind generators to faults. There are rules of controlling the wind generators. For example, if you are not careful, you might have interactions between the controllers, okay? So that is very bad. So we have to study, we have to simulate, okay? So Hydro-Québec builds all this in MTP and they simulate, and the manufacturers, they provide the models of these devices in MTPRV. It's a law in Quebec. And basically, this way, they have a very good fidelity of what is going on. These are, most of them are aggregated, okay? They don't represent the entire wind park, because if you do that, it will take a lot of time to compute, okay? So if you look at this system, so manufacturer black box models, can you see offline simulation, it takes about 1 to 1.5 hours per second. It's quite a lot of time of computations. We accept to wait, okay, but we don't want that. You can use real time, but it's very limited, okay? So you have to, you have several problems. It's not so easy, but it's feasible. So basically the idea is to, you know, to have the same accuracy as offline. So we need to reduce this, okay? And also there is need to do many, many simulations. So the wait time is increasing tremendously. Now let's look at another problem. This is the link between France and Spain. RTE is the French equivalent of Hydro-Québec, basically. So if you look at this link, we only have a simple network equivalent on the Spain side and another one on the French side. And here we are using the new technology of Siemens, which is 400 submodules per arm in the HVDC converters. So we have two converters here. These are giving you the timings. It's quite amazing, right? So this is about 3 hours, okay? But if you, because why? Because we are using here detailed IGBT models. If you go down and you try to use equivalent, you know, make approximations, you can improve it, okay? But you really like this because this is the most accurate, okay? And allows you to do anything you want. These ones are starting to have limitations, but it's one way of saving computing time. The problem is huge. This is a snapshot of EMTP. You can see the module. These are, so there are 400 here, 400 here, right? Everywhere. So this is the assembly of all the IGBTs. Can you see that? So, and inside you have the IGBTs. You have two IGBTs, okay, for each, you know, for each one like that, okay? Why? Because this is the design of the MMC, basically, the way to charge and fire off, fire on. So this is modeled using nonlinear devices. The reason this work was done is because I was studying a paper that was published regarding simulation of MMC HVDC systems in IEEE, and the author was saying that nobody in the near future will be able to simulate such a system in time domain with detailed IGBT. I thought, I didn't understand why he said that. So I said to my student, let's build and simulate. And we did it within about 1 week and it was already running, you know. Why they were not able to do it, I don't know. But I think you have to use very sophisticated mathematical methods like sparse matrices and that kind of stuff to be able to do it. Because of course the number of devices is huge, okay? And of course you have also to have very good nonlinear solvers. It's very complex, but it works very well. You have it in the examples of EMTP if you have EMTP. So we need much faster methods because it's too slow. So the current trend is to implement it in FPGA. But many things that we are doing today are just temporarily, because we do that because we don't have any other solution. But eventually, probably, we will not need it. But many things we have to do it like that. We have no choice because people are demanding it. Okay. So this is another system. Repower is a German manufacturer of wind generators. Actually, now they changed the name. It's called Senbion. And basically, we have a big project with them for studying offshore wind farms. This is a proprietary project in which they study interactions with HVDC systems. So these are HVDC systems, right? Multi-terminal. This is the new trend. Of course, I don't think anything right like that is being built today, but everybody is projecting that. Everybody is trying to build that, okay? Well, it's an issue of economy, right? So if there's a lot of money, they will build it. And these are wind generators. These are detailed, so it means that we have modeled every wind generator. There is no aggregation, okay? Why? Because we want to be as accurate as needed, and I can demonstrate to you that you can make many bad errors if you use aggregation, okay? So let's look at the feeder. So you see we have 10 machines in each feeder, so you have all the feeders. So it's a huge problem, okay? And we also model all the protection systems inside, okay? Overcurrent relays, directional relays, everything is there as in the real park, okay? So it is like an electronic copy of the actual system, okay? Of course, it's too slow. So this is about 57 hours on my computer, okay? And then we can relax. You can see the different flavors of models. Of course, the most accurate one is the first one. Here we are already compromising accuracy, but since we are engineers, we know what we are doing. But ideally, we don't want that. So it's too slow, okay? We need to do research to be faster. This is the entire Hydro-Québec grid assembled in MTP-RV. It is huge. It has everything, you know. It has the static VAR compensators. It has the synchronous machines. In fact, the synchronous machines, in many cases, are modeled individually. It's not an aggregation, okay? So they assemble the exact number of machines in the plant. The transmission lines, the surge arresters, everything is there. It's like an electronic copy of the system. Of course, it's a huge system, okay? So I think only MTP-RV can solve this today. This is actually Montreal, okay? So... And they go down to 69 kV, 120 kV from 735 kV, okay? Why? Because the modeling of the loads is more accurate if you go to the lower levels. And it also allows you to create a nice electronic copy of your system. Anytime you want to do a disturbance somewhere or you want to study the integration of something, you can basically, you have like an electronic copy of the real system, okay? So these are some of the numbers, but it's too long to go through. But basically, oops, you see that you have a... Why it does not go back? So you see that you have about 99 synchronous machines, okay? Well, you can see all the other stuff. So we also have a reduced version of that, but it's still quite big. So let's look again at the timings. As you can see, we have for the large network, if we use a time step of 100 micro, 100 micro is already too high because we have some transmission lines that are short, so we have to go to 50 micro. So this gives you an idea of the time it takes. It's not so bad, actually, okay? But the goal is to increase this. Actually, Hydro-Québec is asking me to multiply this by an order of magnitude. I don't know, 5 times faster, 10 times faster, okay? How can we do faster? Well, I guess we have to invent new techniques. What we are doing today is not enough. The computers are not getting any faster. They are getting parallel. Okay, now very large distribution systems. It's a new trend now to simulate distribution systems. Again, people are now even using it to study stability problems, low flow problems. This is a project that we are doing with Con Edison in New York. New York has a very, very sophisticated system. It's called the Matrix. Basically, they have a lot of redundancy, okay? And you cannot make an equivalent of the system because if something goes wrong somewhere, it affects the rest of the system. So equivalents are really difficult. So typical systems that we simulate might have 200,000 nodes, okay? Electrical nodes. It's huge. It takes too much time, but we simulate it. So again, we need faster methods. This is for studying GMD. I don't know if you are familiar with GMD. GMD is a new problem. I mean, it's an old problem, but it's also a new problem in the sense that in US, they have a law that they have to study GMD perturbations in their grid, geomagnetic disturbances. This is due to the sun, basically. So the sun injects DC in your system and your transformers start saturating, they generate harmonics, the harmonics propagate, you might have static var compensators that trip, so you can have very bad problems, okay? And to imitate that, to simulate that, you have to wait a lot of time before you get into the correct mode of the saturation of the transformers, and you also have to model. So in this case, what we are doing is very fancy. We are doing voltage collapse simulation with the MTP, okay? Of course, it is much more accurate than a traditional voltage collapse tool, and it works quite well. Of course, it takes time, okay? So if we could do this faster, then, you know, it will be fantastic. Okay, so let's now look at the computation of transients, more at the research aspect. We just showed many problems, okay? And we also showed what we can do today. I can claim that all the material I showed you is almost like, you know, the best we can do today, you know? It's really tough. So how to improve this? As I said, we have to benefit from the new computers, parallel environments, okay? So we have to basically develop new methods. So this is what this slide is saying, okay? We have to start thinking parallel. We do not do that normally. When we write software, we do not think parallel, we think sequential. This is the way our brain works, but we have to forget about that. We have to assume that our computer has several cores, and we have to, you know, try to harvest that. We have to develop adaptive models and methods. What it means is that sometimes the frequency is slow, so we don't need the heavy hammer to do it. So maybe we should combine the methods. So we are talking about multi-time frame solutions, okay? Why we are talking about that? Well, it's maybe not necessarily a temporary approach, but at least it's one of the best ideas to accelerate computations, okay? And of course, my goal in the next 5 years is to eliminate, I mean, the gap between offline and real-time simulation tools, to have only one tool that does both. It's not easy, but it can be done. Okay, so this is the long-term objective, create of a unified simulation environment that adapts itself to anything that you are simulating, and it decides for you, it accelerates, it does the accuracy as you want, and it gives you an electronic copy of the network, okay? So how are we going to do that? I think I already explained. We have to parallelize. We have to use new techniques. And we have to use better implementation. So CPU, FPGA, GPU, whatever, okay? But it's not so easy to do these things, okay? First of all, even the compilers, if you buy Visual Studio, for example, you can use OpenNP, but they have many bugs, many problems. You have to fix that. The things do not evolve. The standards are not there yet. So there are a lot of things to do. And people want it now, okay? They don't want to wait. So the multi-time frame approach, the combination of offline and real-time, we have to learn from both worlds, okay? And we have to also work on the models. We have to make the models adaptive, adaptive according to the frequency content. And I am proposing to use the most accurate kernel, but this kernel can be adaptive. Okay, so what is it we mean by saying that we could use different time steps and different methods? For example, if you cut here through the transmission line, maybe you can use another solution method here because you are applying a fault here and it does not do anything in this region. Why we need to use a small time step here? Maybe here we can use a large time step, but it's easy to say that, but it's complicated to do it mathematically, okay? So this is the way we could save computing time. Actually, let's take a longer look. As you saw, I have control systems, right? I have the my machines, and I have every control system. Actually, if we go back just 1 second to... Why nothing is happening? Just a minute. I think it doesn't want to use the duplicate mode. Okay, I'm not going to play with that for the moment because anything can go wrong. So let me go back to... Let me go back to the projection. I'll come back to that, don't worry. Okay, so basically, I think you saw it already, but I wanted to show you live. So we'll try to do it later. I guess what it wants to duplicate the screen. So we have the control systems of the synchronous machine, for example, so it could be control system of anything, a microgrid, or these are block diagrams, okay? They are modeled and assembled differently. And then we have the machine models, we have the line, etc. We have many transformers, okay? And we have an interaction between the controllers and the network. Typically, this is solved using an independent set of equations, okay? And inside here, we have the network equations. We could imagine that we assemble independent sets of network equations because we have decoupling, so we can use parallelization. So in that sense, we could start thinking that every one of them will run on a different CPU already, okay? Then we can start thinking that maybe we could have them using different methods, okay? They don't need to use the same solution method. We could start thinking that this thing is not working well, I don't know why. So we can also think that we are using different time steps, okay? This is the goal, the overall view of what we want to achieve, but it's very complicated to do this, okay? Because it requires reinventing everything we do today in the sense that we are not able today to do this, okay? It's very complicated. So we have to really come up with not only programming ideas, but also numerical and mathematical solution methods. So generically speaking, this is the way it looks, okay? Already, we have the low flow solutions, we have the steady state. The difference between the low flow and the steady state, here we have mathematical constraints, here we have the lump models, okay? And then we have the initialization and we have the time domain solution. Well, already we have problems in data, right? Because every software uses its own data, so I'm gonna skip this slide, it's not very important, but basically we need to work on standardization. Okay, here is the overall view. Basically, the network is solved using what we call a matrix system. This is a linear algebra problem. It's iterative in the sense that although we use this, we solve this by LU decomposition, we have to iterate because there are nonlinearities, so the matrix is continuously updated by nonlinearities. We use something called modified augmented null analysis, and this is applicable to steady state and time domain solutions. Basically, the idea of this generic approach is that we can add any system of equations we want inside, and we are not bounded only by nodal analysis of YN matrix, okay? Here we put currents, but it could be anything. It could be tap changers or any other variables, okay? It could be control systems. So, I'm giving you a very quick example because time is short, but basically here we have a switch. When it is closed, we have 0 volts. And with this open, we have 0 current. So it's quite easy to put this kind of stuff in the system of equations. This is not traditionally done in systems. It's done in EMTP RV, but not in other software. It's very, very powerful, okay? And steady state solution, it's easy. We basically do a phasor solution of that. We assume most of the time we use a linear harmonic steady state solution. It's possible to do a nonlinear harmonic steady state, but it requires too much computing time. So, okay, it has to be faster than time domain solution. So we have to be able to initialize very rapidly, okay? Initialization is important. So the steady state solution is for initialization. I'll give you an example of that system that we just saw. This is the initialized system of the three-phase powers of machines. And this is when you don't initialize. So you may even end up into the wrong solution, okay? So it's very important to initialize, okay? This paradigm, I guess everybody is familiar with that. I don't know, it's really funny because in universities they teach Laplace, etc., which is very important, but they never teach this. This is, I think, as important or sometimes even more important than Laplace. Basically, what it says is that if I have an inductance, instead of going to Laplace, I can make an equivalent resistor and a current source out of it, okay? This was invented many, many years ago. I guess the first paper was published by some guy named Brannin. I forgot. So it's very, very easy. Although many times we use trapezoid integration, like in SPICE, they also use trapezoid integration, okay? It's simple, but it works very well, okay? So this is the trapezoid integration formula. It's very simple, okay? So if you take an inductance and you do the same, you end up having this in the inductance. So this part goes here becomes a resistance, and this is from the past, okay? I guess most of you are familiar with this technique. So I was able to take an inductance and make a resistive circuit out of it, okay? We call this the companion. We can do the same with capacitors, with memory stores, everything we want, okay? So now we have to put that into our solution system. So basically, it's very easy. This part goes into the coefficient matrix. This part goes into the unknowns, and this part goes into the knowns, okay? So we solve it at every time step, okay? We advance, we solve, we advance, we solve, and this changes continuously. This might also change continuously, not because of this, if we have nonlinear functions, okay? So if we have nonlinear functions, well, they become something like that. We linearize them, okay? So if we switch segments, they basically change the resistance, so they change the coefficient matrix. So we have to iterate very efficiently. So this is a simple case taken from a simulation done using SPICE for a nonlinear function. This is the trajectory of the iterations of the Newton method for a diode in SPICE. It takes 300 iterations, Okay? And this is the method using NTPRV, three iterations. Okay? So that's the reason we can simulate the MMC. Otherwise, it will take 1 year. Okay? So you have to really invent very, very fast iterative techniques. And this is a true Newton technique. Okay? There is no cheating. The only thing that is allowing us to do that, it's a special technique inside the MTP that corrects the trajectory of the Newton method. Okay? It's extremely simple, stupid. If I show it to you, you will tell me, oh my god, why it's so simple? Best things in life are very simple. Okay? So state-space analysis, we just spoke about null analysis. State-space analysis, it's very slow because it's very complicated to assemble the A-matrix, okay? But it's used in some applications like Simulink, for example. Assembling the A-matrix requires knowledge of the topological properties, so it's very complicated to do that. But basically, it has some advantages. You can also make it nonlinear in the sense that the matrix here can change. You can say the K version of the matrix because they are switching. It's much more complicated to put switches in the state space matrices, but it's feasible, okay? So I don't recommend using it for large power systems, but if you want to use it for models, it's okay. There is also another technique which is called hybrid analysis. I don't know, it's funny, most people do not know about this. I think Mario told me that you had Professor Chua here, okay? I'm sorry for the drop of the level, but basically, Professor Chua, he was the engineer of this methodology, and he claims, I totally agree with him, that this technique is the most general technique, okay? And from this technique, you can derive many things. My claim is that the most general technique is also the modified null analysis technique from which we can derive hybrid analysis. I think I was the first one to show that. I mean, I claim that. So basically, this is what I'm showing here. You can take the MANA technique and you can concatenate with, branch equations that are nonlinear or linear, doesn't matter. And this part is basically the same as the rest here. I just simplified the notation. And then you can use Gaussian elimination to kill this part and keep only I phi and V phi, because when you do Gaussian elimination, you have fill-in appearing here, right? And these people are eliminated. So you end up having this version here, okay, which is called hybrid analysis. Now you have to identify who goes where, because it's related to topological proper tree. I guess the idea is to, again, use Gaussian elimination, and it's feasible to do that without topological tree search. So this idea allows to calculate the state-space matrices extremely fast, much faster, 100 times faster than the traditional techniques, okay? They are not implemented right now in commercial packages, but the state-space solver exists in MTP, actually. If you notice that, you can drag a state-space device if you want, okay? Okay, now it becomes a bit complicated and time is ticking, but basically you can take the hybrid approach and you can also generate state-space equations, okay? It's quite obvious how it works, but the details are complicated. Now, the nice thing about it is that you can take a network and you can decide that you want to use state-space solutions here, 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 and the rest is nodal. For example, this is nodal. This is nodal, okay? This is nodal, okay? So you can combine it. This is done in the Opal RT simulator, okay? It's a collaboration between me and Opal RT for delivering this. One of the advantages of this technique, it allows you to cut anywhere, not only to transmission lines, okay? Another major advantage is that if you use Opal RT, what they actually do is when they have a converter, they don't want to continuously recalculate the matrices of the converter. It's too much time consuming for real time. So what they do is they save it in memory, okay? Every combination. Of course, if you have 12 switches, you have 2 to the power of 12. When you have 24, now it's becoming impossible, 2 to the power of 24, okay? So it's too much memory, so you cannot do it. But with this technique, you can, because basically all you do is you cut it. Here you put nodal, here you put state space, here you put state space. You have only 212 here, 212 here, okay? So, and you can reduce it more if you want, okay? So I think it's one of the major developments in Opal RT since, the beginning. It allows you to simulate much more complex systems and cut everywhere, not only transmission lines. Combination of state space and modified augmental. Actually, it's called SSN because in the code of Opal, they don't have modified augmental. They have nodal analysis, the traditional nodal analysis. Okay, well, it's complicated to explain that, so I'm going to skip it, okay? So let's go. Okay, it went too fast for some reason, yeah. Okay, so now let's look more about parallelization, okay? We said that we can parallelize through transmission lines, Actually, something that is not explained in the literature is that modified augment analysis is related to dioptics, and it's also, you know, you can also use it for parallelization, of course. What does it mean? It means that we take our matrix AX equal B and we try to create islands. In this case, we have transmission lines, okay? So they are pure islands, there is no approximation. So this can run on one processor, another processor, so you can use as many processors as we want. But this is only with transmission lines, okay? If the transmission lines do not exist, we need to do something else. So let's take a look. This is a big system, like the one of Hydro-Québec I showed you. This is the matrix at the beginning. So of course, it's not easy to parallelize this, right? It's one huge block. But this is what happens if you do the ordering, which is called the block diagonal form. It exists in the KLU package. I don't know if you are familiar with the sparse matrix solver. The reason he called it KLU, it's because of Clark Kent, because there was another package called Super LU, so Superman, you know, Kent. So they decided to call it KLU, okay? It's a bit funny, but that's the way. So basically, as you can see now, I have blocks here, you know? I can simulate them independently, okay? Depending on the number of cores I have. Of course, the problem is still complicated because I have nonlinear functions, so I have to update them. I might have switches. Of course, we were discussing with Mario today the problem of switching, because when we switch, we continuously have to update this matrix. The nice thing now, we are updating a smaller matrix, and so we are restarting the LU on a smaller matrix, okay? However, the problem is still there. Somebody has to find a solution, okay? There are many, many things being done on that. Okay, there is a link between modified augment analysis and dioptics. Okay, I published this in a recent document. It did not appear yet, but basically the Krohn dioptics was assuming that you were cutting in the middle of a device. Okay, I know this sounds a little bit crazy, but there is no need to think like that. We can cut in anywhere, right? So. And in modified augmented analysis, you realize that we have the notion of a wire, which is a closed switch, right? So, you know, dioptics is very simple, you know. It has a fancy name, and if you look at the theory, oh, it's so complicated. But it's not complicated at all. It's very simple, okay? It's just cutting through wires. So let's do that, and we will end up basically putting our system and then the switches. These are the switches. So this reordering is basically showing you that, unfortunately, we do not have transmission lines everywhere, so we have some S matrices that are not zero, okay? And then we can demonstrate, it's a bit more work, that SD with wires, of course, it's zero. And if SD is zero, then we can demonstrate that you can solve the switch currents first before solving the rest. So you can parallelize now the rest. Okay. However, the implementation of that is far from being done. It's complicated, but theoretically, I can demonstrate that to you. Okay. So we are working on that right now. Okay. Well, another crazy, crazy idea. I call it the PIMC approach. Actually, it was originally invented by one of my friends, but nobody looked at it, and the paper is there somewhere. But you know, it's called parallel implicit multi-step integration. What does it mean? As you saw today, I was solving this system using time steps, right? I was solving this part, so points. I was going like that, okay? But that is very slow in a sense. So my dream, my goal, is to be able to do a complete set. For example, I would like to solve between 700 milliseconds and 800 milliseconds in one shot. So the waveform appears, bang, okay? So the idea is extremely simple, but it's complex to generalize it, okay? The idea basically says, okay, so let's write the equations for the entire set, okay? Not only for each time point. So it means that we basically concatenate all the time point solutions, okay? And it looks like this. So you basically have the time moving like that, and you have the first solution at time zero, then the following solution depends on that one, etc. So you have a huge sparse matrix. Okay? Of course, you have to decide how much resources you have, and you can decide the extent. Is it 100 milliseconds, 50 milliseconds, 1 millisecond? But if you solve it, you get the entire waveform in one shot, right? Now, the problem is that you will have nonlinear functions, etc. But it can be done, okay? It's a lot of mathematical theory, but I mean, if we are able to do that, then we'll become faster than real time at some places, right? So, especially with implementations like FPGA, I don't know. Okay, the law flow solution, again, the same idea of modified augmented null analysis. There is a law flow in EMTP. When I started looking at law flow solutions, I was impressed because they have a lot of multi-phase law flow papers in the literature. And there are some people, every time they add a wire, they publish a new paper, okay? So they're able to solve three wires. They add another wire, they publish a new paper. I couldn't understand why it was so complicated. So I did something very, very simple, stupid. And when I did it and I implemented it, it worked. So I realized maybe it's not so stupid. So actually it is the most generic law flow solution that you can find today. It can solve anything. It has no limitations, no complexes. It does something very simple, and I can prove it to you mathematically. That's the Newton method. It basically takes the network equations and concatenates with the constraints, okay? So again, augmented approach. There's nothing else to do. That's it. We don't need to write the Jacobian matrices. That's crazy. It takes a lot of time. I don't know why they do that, you know? I cannot understand. I don't know why they work in per unit. I don't understand. There's no need to do that, okay? Well, I know why they do that, but there's no need to do that, okay? In our case, we don't work in per unit, we work in actual values. And you can make this thing, of course, you have to implement it correctly, okay? You can use fancy techniques if you want. You can use dogleg, for example, because it is sensitive to initial conditions and that kind of stuff. But it worked very well. I don't see many cases that the MTPRE diverges. And you can put many different types of controls, etc., if you want. Okay, as I told you, it's the most generic method. There are no restrictions, okay? Well, here's an example of a constraint. I won't go through that. It's too long. Time is passing, but if you want more. Okay, here's another thing on which we are working. Basically, I call it the time warp. It means that you are simulating. Of course, you start with the lot flow. Then you do time domain, right? And then you continue. Let's say you want to simulate with EMTPRV for, 100 seconds, okay? You can do that. Actually, I can show you a case today where I start a synchronous machine and simulate for 500 seconds or something like that, and it will be very fast. We won't have to wait 500 seconds, okay? But then it's a bit annoying because why we have to do time domain everything? What if we could do jumps? For example, we do lot flow, we go time domain, and then we know that there is going to be something in 50 minutes from now, okay? A load change, a tap change, a position change. We don't want to see how it goes there. We don't want to wait till it starts. We want to be there. So what we do is we do another load flow, okay? That moves us to that particular place. Of course, it's easy to say this, but we have to initialize the controls, everything. And then we do another time domain at that particular location. So basically, MTPRV will be, or AMTP, any MTP, will be able to jump in time. You will be doing time warps, okay? So I think it's feasible to do this. Okay, control systems. As you know, we need to also do control system solutions. Right now, the control solver of EMTP is using a sparse matrix formulation that is as big as a network by using perturbation, okay? It's very good. I think, it's as good as the one in Simulink. But it's too big, the system. So we created a new one that is using only the feedback points. It's called feedback point perturbation system. It is being published currently. It's in review mode, so hopefully it will be accepted. That increases the computation time by 4 by 5 without even parallelizing, okay? Decreases the computation time by 4 by 5. So it's another idea. So there's so many things to do that are there waiting for us to discover. It's amazing, you know? Okay, I won't go through this. Now we have only a few minutes left, so let me go to the next slide. If this thing allows me, please. Okay, so I would like to present you very, very, very quickly a project I have at my university. One of the objectives, of course, if you are interested, is we need a lot of students. And of course, we officially indicated that we will co-direct the students with the professors of EPFL. For example, I indicated officially the name of Mario Palloni. So if you want to do studies in this particular chair, it can be done. And we have a lot of funding, of course. So this is a bit advertisement. Who are the partners of this chair? The chair is related to all what I told you, you know, very very fast computations of transients. So we have Electricité de France, which is the French company, Hydro-Québec, Opal-RT, and Réseau de Transport d'Électricité. And we have the Canadian government. It's basically a concourse. So the companies give you funding, and then you apply, and then you go through committees, and you wait, and they ask you questions, and you have to defend yourself. And you have to publish many papers, okay? As you know, professors, we have to have papers, okay? It's a funny way of evaluating that, because there are people that you probably know, like the guy that in Boson, you know, X guy, I think he didn't ever publish a paper. Am I correct? Or so the best inventions are not necessarily papers, but it's our way of measuring the professor. So, and then eventually you can get the grant if you have enough papers, etc. And you can also name collaborators. As I told you, I officially named Mario in this list. So we have actually four collaborators of universities. So this is the list of projects. As you can see, we have about 7 PhD, we have 8 master's students, we have 4 postdoc, we have 1 associate, and these are the projects, okay? It's 5 years duration, and so there is a prototyping platform, wideband and adaptive line and cable models, adaptive synchronous and asynchronous machine models, power electronics, research on power electronics, the new law flow solution methods I showed you, okay? Sparse matrix solvers, I kind of touched it today. Hybrid methods, multi-time frame, and of course, real time, okay? So this is the list of projects. I have the details here, but it's too long. So if you are interested to work with us, just contact us, Mario or me, and we can exchange on that. And officially the chair is starting in January, okay? So to conclude, my research vision was presented today. I showed you what can be done and what we are trying to do. So basically, we need to continue doing a lot of work to deliver new and advanced numerical methods for the computational power system transients. We have to be extremely fast as we can. In fact, when we become very, very fast, they want us to be faster, okay? So there is no limit. If we make it extremely fast, then they will build bigger systems, okay? And if we make that one faster, they will build something bigger. So it will never finish. So we have to really maintain this and find ways to upgrade it very, very rapidly. So we have to establish new parallel ways of doing simulations, generically speaking. I am dreaming of unifying everything, okay? And reducing the gap between real-time and offline. I don't know why we should have this difference. We should have only one simulator that does everything, that does electromechanical transients. Actually, MTP can do electromechanical transients, but you know, it takes more time, okay? So this is my dream, okay? So I don't know, I just want to take 1 second more. I need to fix that problem with the computer. So this is a typical system that you simulate in EMTP. And this is actually part of the Turkish grid. And in this case, we are studying the startup of a machine. It's unique to do that in EMTP. So the simulation time is going to be very long, 400 seconds. And it won't take 400 seconds. It will take maybe 60 seconds to run this. So faster than real time in a way, but not synchronous real time, okay? So, and then you have basically here everything. You have the machine controls. You have the synchronization equipment. Okay, so what is it doing? It's basically comparing the voltage magnitudes, the frequency, and the angle, and it's synchronizing the machine and starting it up from zero, okay? This is one example. Let me show you the Hydro-Québec grid. So this is the province of Quebec, okay? And you can see the interconnections we are very special in Hydro-Québec. We only have DC interconnection. We don't have synchronous interconnections, okay? So we connect to Ontario, to New York, etc., and New Brunswick. So if we enter every place, we will see this is a subcircuit, of course. We can see now the entire, of course, this is a secret. Oh, if you steal my computer, I will be in, well, you can't do anything. It is encrypted. But basically, this is a big secret, right? It's the entire grid, okay? This is the island of Montreal, okay? So you see all the, and you see it is laid down, the north is actually on this side, right? You can see the static VAR compensators. This is the north, okay? So you have Bay James, we have two corridors, Bay James and Churchill. If you get inside, you will see the synchronous machines. Every detail is there, right? Everything is there, even the bus bar, you know, the switching, the low flow constraints, okay? You can continue like that. You can navigate to the system. Right now, we are upgrading the graphical user interface. Hopefully, in June, we'll have a new version. We added many navigation tools, and we also changed the look and feel. It looks more like the modern office, etc. People like that, okay? So, This is another example. The HVDC link I already showed you. So this is inside the system. If you go to the, to see the, this is huge, of course. So let's go into one arm. These are all the, can you see that? It's crazy, eh? But it works. See? And then we have the IGBTs, okay? So it takes a lot of resources and numerical computational power, iterative solutions, you know, sparse matrices to be able to do this, okay? But it has to be faster. So that is my talk today. I hope it was interesting. And please, if you have questions.
Thank you very much. Questions. I hope that you still have some energy to pose questions to Jan. Please introduce yourself before.
No, you can't do that. You have to have a question.
You have to have a doctor a question.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Nicholas. I'm working for the EMC lab with Dr. Rashidi.
Yes.
And actually, I'm very interested about the last part where you mentioned that you could, let's say, somehow jump in time because there is nothing that will happen in a steady state.
Actually, yes,
yeah. In electromagnetics, we do have a lot of these problems because sometimes you're waiting for the wave to propagate. And
yes, yeah.
Interesting effect.
Yes, yeah.
So do you have already some solutions for this kind of problem, or it was just an idea?
No, I do, but it's being, you know, it's coming in papers, but it takes time, right? So right now, as you know, EMTP inside, it initializes, okay? I think you are familiar with EMTP a little bit. So basically what I do is if I take a synchronous machine like that, inside I put the low flow constraint, okay? I say that this machine has to produce 132 megawatts at the voltage of 13.8 kV. So I take this constraint, I solve the low flow, it's a nonlinear problem. Then I take the machine equations and initialize them, okay? I also initialize the controls because here we have the governor and the exciter. So it has to provide the correct mechanical power to deliver this power, and it has to provide the correct excitation to control this voltage. So that that part is, the rest, all the network solution initialization is automatic. Linear, but automatic. However, so it starts in steady state. The difficulty is with controls, okay? Initializing controls is really very, very complicated because you might have more than one solution, right? For example, if you have a block that uses the absolute value. I'll give you an example, okay? So what we do is we take the information from the machine which gives us the steady state solutions, like you will see it's steady state, field voltage, and we use a memory hold technique then, and when then we initialize the blocks, okay? What does it mean? Well, we basically say T goes to infinity, S goes to zero, okay? So this does a quite good job. You know, it's not perfect, but it does a quite good job. As you can see, these blocks are all initialized, okay? So it already starts in steady state. So we don't have to wait till the you know, the waves propagate, because if I do that with the Hydro-Québec system, it will never finish. It will take years, and then eventually it will go somewhere that we do not want to go, okay? So initialization is fundamental. However, this is not enough, because this is just initializing, starting the system, going into time domain, and then if somebody wants to do something, a fault or an event, he can do that. But some people, they do a fault, they do something, and then they know that it has an impact, for example, on a tap changer. But tap changers are very slow, you know, they can take 30 seconds to move or something like that. So you don't want necessarily to wait till the tap changer moves and to see all the transients. You don't want that. I mean, you want to be at the new stage where the tap changer goes or somewhere in between and do something else. So this does not allow you to do that, because it still has to wait to every time point. With that approach I showed you, where I want to basically take that time domain solution, feed the law flow with that, and find the solution in the next for the time point of 50 seconds. And then at that point, I restart again time domain. This is what I call time warp. It's jumping in time, right? So yes, this is something that I'm trying to implement. The many times when I do things, you know, I cannot just publish a paper on a small network or something like that. The people that I work with will kill me. They don't want that, okay? So I have to do, for example, if you look at the literature, there are many papers, they parallelize solutions they do. But most of the time, they use a simple network. They don't have a real software. In a real software, there is memory, dumping of scopes. There are many things going on, you know, handling of data. So, you know, many things that literature says do not really work. It's just academical. So we have to move it to, so when I publish something, it really has to work for any case, okay? So it takes more time. That dream is very complex, but, you know, it's working now for a small system, but we have to extend it to something big.
Okay.
Other questions?
Please. Well, otherwise I'll be sad if you don't ask any questions.
I'm sure
you have a question. Yes, one more. Continue. Can we give something like iPads or something like that? No.
I have something in my backpack. We'll award the best question of the session.
You showed us before some numbers in the orders of tens of thousands of seconds.
Yes, yes,
and
hours.
Hundreds of thousands of seconds.
In one case, we had 220, 67 hours. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's right. Like an inner scoop profiling question, like where is that time spent? What's the computational
time? Uh-huh. Yes.
Time?
Yes, actually you saw it in one of the slides because I went too quickly. So let's go back maybe. See if we go here and we remove this guy temporarily. See the time step, and then you have the GUI file loading. Okay, this is funny, but it's complex. You have to do it quickly, so it's not so bad. Okay, data generation, low flow solution. Okay, so this is the time it takes to do it. Okay. It's not so bad, right? Because we are dealing with a huge system, okay? And then you have steady-state solution, it's nothing, okay? Very quick. Then we have the time-domain network equation C, the updating, the control equations, and the updating of the equation C. The bottleneck is the sparse matrix, okay? So that's the reason I was showing the fact that if I can parallelize the sparse matrix, I can save a lot of time. So the sparse matrix solution is taking a lot of time.
Yeah.
Then, of course, we can parallelize the models. We published papers on how to do that. I mean, how to not parallelize for the moment. We didn't publish on parallelization. We published on how to accelerate their computations and to also to put it in real time in some cases. But the main problem is the big system of equations because it's iterative, right? We also have to update. When you say that you are doing 10 seconds, in reality, maybe you are doing 50, 60, I don't know, because it continuously, you know, inside it does one, two, three iterations per second, right? So does this answer your question?
Yeah, actually it was a question that I knew almost the answer for. So I have a follow-up.
Please, that's great, yeah.
Given that, I mean, everyone was expecting, okay, sparse matrices, huge number of, huge size and so on. So given that there has been recently at least quite good advance in sparse solvers like multifrontal techniques,
yes, yes,
domain decomposition, and you name,
yeah.
Have you something that is of that caliber in EMPPRV, or you're using something that was done? Okay, now I'm speaking as a software engineer. Like 10 years ago, it's legacy. You keep it because it works.
Well, there are two. Did you finish?
Yeah.
Okay. The question is very, very interesting. Actually, there are two aspects to your question. Number one aspect is that there is the official software. So before you touch anything, you have to make sure that it does not change the answers. Changing the sparse matrix solver of a software is easy to do. Actually, EMTP, the way it's designed, it's plug and play. You can, if you want to do research in that field, I can show you it's a DLL that you change. If you want to do it, it's feasible. However, this is funny, but if you are familiar with linear algebra, probably it's your case, the answer may not be necessarily the same. Why? Because it's using a new scheme for ordering and it changes the accuracy, right? So the solver I have right now is a sparse matrix solver based on the Yale package. Do you know the Yale package? Well, it uses partial pivoting, so it's quite accurate, okay? It also uses minimum degree ordering, which is quite good. But it's not as fast as the techniques that I'm showing you here. So what we did for the moment is we replaced, you said that there are many inventions, you are right, and we tried them all. It's really funny because most of them did not really gain much. Okay? However, there is one that gained, I think I showed the number, by an order of 2, 3, even 4 in some cases, is called KLU. KLU is actually a solver that is based on the BTF approach. So And then it uses a special technique. I can show you if you want, but it's a little bit complicated. But basically, it uses a special techniques for doing the solution, the LU solution, and it's extremely fast. And the guy who created that, there is a book published by him, Mr. Davis. He also worked on a parallel version of this thing himself. So us, we're going to parallelize it ourselves, okay? But it's not doing that well for the moment, according to our tests. So yes, we are using the modern techniques, but we will not instantaneously the next day change the commercial version. Okay, how do we check the accuracy? Basically, we do the residues. So we take the solution AX equal B, and we do AX minus B, and we look which one is the best. And surprisingly, I don't know why, so far my old technique was the most accurate, okay? So before I switch to the new one, I have to make sure that it is as accurate. Sometimes I play with the options because they have various options on pivoting, and when I do that, the computing time is very bad. So it's really complicated, okay? You do not sleep, basically. You spend your time thinking of it. Your wife talks to you and she gets mad at you because you are thinking of that. It's not good, okay? There are things in our jobs that are not necessarily good. We become zombies, okay? So, yes? Yes or no, you know, we have particular problems that the GPUs are not doing well. If you look at the literature, people that worked on SPICE acceleration, most of them use what I said, KLU or this stuff. The GPUs, it's complicated because we have to continuously change the matrix. So we have to do things that the GPU does not perform well. It's better for problems that are well fixed, well established. Okay, it's also not bad maybe if you use other solution methods. For example, you can use these solvers that we are using are not iterative in the sense that we do LU decomposition. There is another approach called iterative solvers, which they don't do. It's like the Jacobia, you know, where they basically are able to find the inverse of the matrix without using LU decomposition. So maybe, but for the moment, literature in our field shows that the best way is basically this method, KLU for SPICE. Some people use iterative solvers. Some people use FPGAs, but those that did that used it on small systems or systems that don't have too much nonlinearities. And some of them were achieving faster than real time, actually. But the problem is, you know, they have a network, they do fault. The location they do the fault is very far from the synchronous machine. So when I review the paper, I tell them, why don't you put the fault near the machine? So they don't do that because when they do that, it slows down. So, but there is a lot of hardware aspects. So the job is not easy. We need people that are good in math. We need people that like programming. I don't know why in Quebec, many students, they don't like programming. I hope you like programming here. When I was young, we loved programming, you know. We started, I guess nobody here, maybe Farad, I don't know, we had decks of cards. Do you remember cards? You remember that? So you don't look old, I mean, why are you? yeah. Okay, so maybe. But it was crazy. We had the patience to program with the decks of cards. In my case, I had to give it to some guy that would send it to the government overnight, and then the government computer would send it back the next day. And sometimes you would drop the decks of cards on the floor, and they would be all messed up. You remember those days? And we love doing that. Today, you have tremendous computer. I mean, it's amazing why people do not like computing, at my place at least. Maybe here you like a lot. But programming is so much fun. It's unbelievable. If you develop software, like I was lucky in my case, I developed a software that is used worldwide, okay? It's like my soul is traveling, you know? When people ask me questions about the MTBREs that they are getting into my life, it is amazing to develop software, okay? So I forgot why I started this discussion, but basically I said something about, what was the question?
I guess that the deck of cards was biasing you.
Yeah, but what was the question? Did I answer the question?
I was asking about why not use it on
GPUs. Yeah. That I started talking about programming. Yeah, I said we need mathematical people, we need to do a lot of programming, patience. We need also power system people, because somebody can say, why don't you give it to, well, they don't know what we want. They don't know that what is a synchronous machine. What is it we can do with a synchronous machine to make it faster, because they don't know the equations of the machine. They don't know the applications. So we need both worlds, okay? So another question, please.
Yeah,
You just need to ask a small question. I can talk 5 more minutes, you know. Yes, fantastic. The decks of cards.
Yeah, but such large systems. You were talking about accuracy, and you said that you have better accuracy. How do you define and check their accuracy?
Okay, very good question. I'm not sure I have a clear answer, but the answer for the moment is purely mathematical. So we solve, we basically, first of all, we assume that the models are accurate. What does it mean? It means that from the history of the software, etc., because this software, you know, there was another version before. There were basically the companies that funded this thing, they did a lot of tests, real life tests. So when we talk about the line model, we are sure that it's very good, okay? So we are sure that the model is good. The numerical techniques are supposed to be good because we are supposedly experts on how to develop that, etc., and we compare that to tests. So we have some levels of reference. Okay, then the next step is to solve it using AX equal B. So how do I determine the accuracy of that? I do AX minus B. If it's zero, almost zero, then I think it's sufficiently accurate. Okay, so. I mean, that's the best answer I can give you. Of course, there are many, many assumptions. But surprisingly, you know, nobody can, you know, I haven't seen cases where people do an experimental study and they come up and they are not able to reproduce it eventually. It's not so easy, you know, because people originally they will build it in MTP and then it will not give the same answer, okay? Because why? Because I'll give you an example. Somebody goes into the field and energizes a line and then he records everything and takes MTP and the answer is not the same and he says, what's wrong? But what he forgets is when he closed the breaker restrikes, pre-strikes. So what we do is we take the waveform at the end of the breaker to make sure that we know exactly what he injected on the line because there is a lot of random aspects, right? So, you know, then we have sufficient good accuracy, and I have never seen basically cases that we are not able to reproduce, you know. Sometimes it's much more work. So the models are good, and then AX minus B should be zero, approximately. We can iterate to make it more, but, you know, there is a trend. You cannot do too much because it slows down, okay? So you decide, okay, it's enough. You know, it's if you are dealing with watts when we are looking at megawatts, you don't care about watts, okay? So it's enough. Okay?
Other questions?
Yes, please.
In the very last slide where you show the new projects that are coming.
Yeah, yeah.
There is a chapter called the wideband modeling of cables.
Yes.
What is it about?
Well, if I don't know if you follow the literature, but historically we did many things on the wideband line and cable models. We also did real-time version of that, and we are just also in the middle of writing another paper that shows how to accelerate it a lot. The wideband models are good for a wide frequency range. Okay, that's the reason we call it wideband. In this project, we do not necessarily intend to work on particular techniques like the fitting problem, which is not yet solved, by the way. It's a complex problem. We do not want to work on the approach of the numerical technique of the wideband model as such, but what we want to do is we want to make it much faster and make it adaptive. Okay, why? Because sometimes we are dealing with 60 hertz. Why do we need to go to all these complex equations to solve for 60 hertz? But it's easy to say this, but when you start programming that and you see, oh yeah, why it does not work, you know, because it goes through all the details, it has history. So can we cheat? Can we do some things to? Well, there are some ideas to basically have that kind of work done, and the model adapts itself to the speed of the transient. So it has to have some history to adapt, right? And then variable time step. Okay, right now all the solvers are fixed time step. Why? Because it's very slow to do variable time steps. If you use SPICE, it uses variable time steps. It's damn slow, SPICE. I mean, it's very slow. We cannot do that for the moment, but we want to do that because it's nice to have variable time steps. If you see that things are becoming, it's based on Taylor series, okay? It's all mathematical, but when things are becoming fast, you reduce the time step, and they slow down, you increase the time step. But then the model has to adapt itself, because if you take the wideband model, you use larger time steps, sometimes it does not behave well. So that's the explanation of that, okay?
Other questions from the audience?
Please.
Actually, I have one question for you. Yeah. You were talking about the time warp.
Yes, yeah.
We have a system that assumes it can be nonlinear. So you can have multiple solutions. So when you have the time warp, you have a unique trajectory. It seems to be having a unique trajectory.
I am assuming, yeah.
You're assuming that.
Yeah.
But in reality, when you deal with nonlinearity, even in the load flow solution, when you jump from one time set to the other, you can jump into a different solution of the system. So how into an approach like that you choose the trajectory of your system?
Well, I guess this thing is a bit, let me explain you more what I mean by this. When I'm solving here in time domain, I have my network with a given set of loads, given initial solution from the load flow, and then I'm in time domain. That time domain reproduces perfectly what the load flow said here, okay? But then I know here that maybe in 1 hour or 50 minutes or 10 seconds, I don't know, there will be a tap that will move and will go to another. So I'm already establishing, by going to the next load flow solution, that particular condition. It is like doing what some people do where they do repetitive load flows. How does it call it?
Some continuous load flows.
Yeah. Or they call it also... No, continuation is more for the voltage collapse. I think this is more... Yeah, something like that, yeah. And it's called... they basically repeat load flows after load flows to do time domain. Yeah, it is also the same for continuation, but there is another word that they use when they basically do load flow, not for the continuation necessarily. They do it generically speaking. So in my case, I will have the advantage of having the time domain solution at that particular location that I will feed to the load flow solution, that I know exactly where it is, okay? And I have also initialized automatically because I am in time domain, all the controls, everything is correct. Then I will go to the load flow and it will give me the condition of steady state at that particular point in time. And I will restart from that. Okay?
And in case you don't have, you missed your solution.
The word was time series solution of load flows. That was the term I was. In case I don't have the unicity, it means that, you know, it will mean that that particular condition that I'm asking for the tap or the load, might have more than one solution. I don't think it will be the case. I will not be able to find it if it exists. I can find it. I mean, if you are thinking about, for example, cases where you have, voltage collapse or where you have two solutions for the voltage, I mean, you can. The load flow that I'm using here does not allow to find that. Okay, it converges. If it can converge above the knee. However, you can see it in time domain. Yeah. But
it would be interesting to have to analyze the bifurcation of the solutions.
Potentially, maybe we can do it. I didn't think about that for the moment, but potentially, that's the reason there's collaboration in my chair. So basically, the time domain solution, maybe potentially, I don't know the answer to that, could help you do that. Because in our load flows for the moment, we do not use what you said, continuation load flow that is done for the knee. But you know, the knee actually, in reality, nobody goes below the knee because the equipment will all trip. It is just to visualize a trajectory, okay? When we show these things, people think that nobody goes there, you know? This is, it's just, but in time domain, yes, you can go there and come back, okay? Maybe, actually, it's a good idea. Maybe that will allow us, I don't know, you know, that will allow us to study things that we cannot study with ordinary load flow.
Thank you, Jean. Other questions from the audience?
One more, so. Other professors maybe want to ask a question or make a comment or.
Well, I guess that we can close here.
Okay.
The session. I would like to thank you once more. And
thank you very much. Thank you very much.